The following is a Comfortably Zoned Radio Network production.
I am back, and you're flying high over the zone, but it's a somber zone. I'm Ralph Tyko, and my guest is a grieving Michael Duca. Michael, you lost your wife's mother, and condolences from everybody at the Comfortably Zoned Radio Network.
Well, thank you, Ralph. I appreciate the thought.
Yeah, life goes on, I guess, or it's all part of it, but it doesn't make it any easier when you're going through it. And I'm going through it to a lesser extent today. I just found out this morning that Keely Smith passed away. Michael, we haven't talked music at all, but Keely was forever connected with Louis Prima, and she was, in her own right, a terrific talent and a comedian. She had deadpan expressions on stage, a terrific stage. She complimented one of those ever-ready bunnies who keeps on going and going, and that was Louis Prima. She just stood there at times and watched him. At times she'd join in the fun. But they were, in my day, the 50s, early 60s, that type of thing, me growing up, they were called the Vegas Act, and they were friends of Sinatra. They played the lounge, and Keely Smith did a lot of Frank songs over the years. So it's kind of rough for all in the zone today. Michael, let me segue to something that might cheer us up. I'm going to throw a little Louis Prima and Keely Smith singing Old Black Magic. And it was the first song. I'm a little kid just reaching puberty. I realized how music can affect you in different ways, different ways. Listen to this and tell me what you think, Michael Duca. Here we go. I'm pushing a button. Here we go.
Old black magic has me in a spell.
Old black magic that you weave so well.
Those icy fingers up and down my spine.
The same old witchcraft when your eyes meet mine.
Same old tingle that I feel inside.
And then that elevator starts to dry.
Down and down I go.
Round and around I go.
Like a leaf caught in a tide.
I should stay away, but what can I do?
For you're the lover I have waited for.
You're the mate that fate had me created for. And every time your lips be mine.
Baby, down and down I go. Round and round I go. Let it spin. Love the spin I'm in. On the old
fire.
you're the lover I have waited for.
Tyko, I'm with Michael Duca, who is a Renaissance man, an author, official scorer, and a whole bunch of other things that I don't even know about. What you doing right now, Michael? You cook.
What I'm doing right now is getting ready for all of my kids to come over for Christmas dinner. So
nice.
part is cooking, and part is cooked, and part will be cooking soon. And in the meantime, you just played for everybody, and I'll bet even you don't know this. You just played for everybody the very first Grammy-winning song for a vocal group.
Whoa. I did not know that. That was probably 1957, I would say, somewhere.
59.
59, okay.
59.
Right. I was 13 years old. Those feelings were just starting for the old Zigzag Man, and that was a powerful song on radio back east. It affected a lot of people, and it basically made their careers. But they were most famous for playing in Vegas and just entertaining. So may she
rest. It's very interesting. You know, Keely Smith was a stage name. Her real name was
Canadian.
Dorothy Jacqueline Keely. No, she was born in Norfolk, Virginia. She's a U.S. citizen. Her dad was in the military. And this is the part that I thought I remembered, but I didn't want to say it without looking it up to make sure. She was Cherokee. Irish and Cherokee.
I did not know that. I don't know where it came in my mind that she was Canadian, maybe because of her dialect, her I don't know what it is. I thought she was Canadian, but Cherokee, interesting. Very interesting look. That deadpan expression on stage was priceless.
When she first came up and first started singing with Louis Prima, she had a short bob haircut. But she let her hair grow. I think maybe in a nod to her Cherokee heritage, she let her hair grow down past her shoulders. And to me, that sort of made her the prototype for Cher.
Good analogy. Yes. She was somewhat sultry in a reserved sort of way, as was Cher. Cher would just look off into the camera and away from the camera and adjust her hair, much like Keely Smith did on stage. She had these little mannerisms that Louis Prima would mock and jokingly mock on stage. They were excellent together. He was quite what an interesting guy that was, Louis Prima.
Well, it's hard for me to think of Louis Prima and not have two immediate things come to mind. First thing that comes to mind is Spike Jonze, because they were of the same era and they were the same talented musicians who made careers a little bit out of clowning around music. But as someone who I knew personally and who was a great talent, Victor Borga, proved in order to sound bad being funny playing music, you have to be awfully good.
Victor Borger spent more time on Ed Sullivan's show than Ed Sullivan, it seemed.
Well, and that was probably a good thing because he was a lot more entertaining than Ed.
Absolutely was. He was very dry. He was amongst the... You had to really look for his humor, but it was there. It was good, excellent stuff. He played the piano and joke and... He had a dialect. Where was he from, Victor Borger? You knew
Denmark.
Him?
Denmark. Okay. He escaped the Nazis just before Denmark was invaded.
Whoa. Very interesting, because my father escaped the Nazis through Brussels from Poland. And
was he a mere sprout at the time?
He was 30s, early 30s.
Oh, well, that does not qualify him as a Brussels sprout, then.
No. Oh, I got you there. that's very, very good.
And as I said a moment ago, there were two things that come to mind immediately when you say Louis Prima, and the other is what I think is possibly the most sumptuous and one of the most beautifully filmed movies ever. A movie that didn't get near the airplane.
The one about food. The one about food,
well,
am I correct?
The Big Night.
With the critics?
And what's really interesting about The Big Night is that after watching it a couple of times, I was actually inspired. Those few people in the audience who've seen the movie will remember this. That the centerpiece of that magnificent dinner for Louis Prima, who never showed up at the restaurant, was a timbalo, which is a molded pasta dish that's made in a colander. You actually press the pasta around the outside in a pattern and then fill it with alternating layers of sauce and cheese and meatballs and sausage. And, you know, It's sort of a lasagna made incredibly difficult.
And I made one for Christmas that year. Few people that didn't see that movie, I mean, I thought I was the only one that did. And I went to see it because it was a Louis Prima score, basically. They played Louis Prima movie music all through the movie. But I was just fascinated by the colors of the food and the beauty of a prepared plate. You know, I was a guy who grew up on Chef Boyardee. My mother used a pressure cooker as a weapon. It was... we got letters from the neighbor, your mother's killing Jews. We got to stop... Gotta stop having our kids come over.
Right.
Not a good cook, and cooking was not a big thing in my life. And then I went into the Air Force, and I, you know, mess all food, and because of my
and I got news for you: the Air Force gets the best food.
Can you imagine what the other services get, for crying out? But I, not to complain, it was luxury, literally. They gave you a chow hall pass, which meant that you could literally 24 hours a day find an open chow hall on the base somewhere if you were hungry. And we used to, you know, laugh about it, but that was good food. But not gourmet food, and wasn't ever exposed to that except on rare occasions. This movie showed what you're going through today, preparing for a meal for your late Christmas dinner. These people were just trying to get noticed, and with their new venture, the restaurant. and it shows them getting ready and getting the ingredients, and terrific movie, terrific score as well. So
it's interesting, Ralph. Do you think that movie would have been more popular if it had been 5 years later, when all of a sudden everybody wanted to know everything about the Jersey Shore? Because that was really the movie that woke people up to the existence of the Jersey Shore, except for those people who were just major, serious Bruce Springsteen fans.
Mm-hmm. Good question. I'm so out of touch with what's going on in terms of recent sociology. Recent sociology is sickening. We can't talk about that on any level without making ourselves ill. But I what I'm talking about is I don't know if you know that for the major part of the last 25 years, I would say, I've been what is known as van man. I've lived my life in vans, camper vans, and motorhomes, and stayed close. I was the stay-at-home dad for my son's first 5 years, so I was always close and around Alameda, but I've been just a radio guy, as I was as a kid, as opposed to TV, as opposed to movies. So the movie which we're talking about, it's almost kismet. I can't think of five movies that I've seen over the last 25 years in a theater, and that was one of them. So it's really weird. So my social interaction from the standpoint of what's popular has been very, very limited. So long about answer. I can't give you an answer. How's that? To that question.
Well, okay.
All right.
All right.
But
then.
Never have I come away from a movie. I remember where I saw it. It was up in Sebastopol. And never have I come up, or Roanoke Park, somewhere around there, come away from feeling hungry and appreciative of the whole process of food, not just, you know, it's hot, eat it, you know, there you go.
Oh, no, no. For those of us who cook, Ralph, cooking is our form of creativity. I mean, I can't paint. I can't sing very well. I don't play music anymore. I haven't for 40 years. But I can cook. And, you know, it's a way of demonstrating care and concern and love for those around you. And, you know, it's a fascinating thing because, you know, I once had an experience a little bit like what went on in the movie. I mean, not to the extent of cooking something magnificent and knowing nobody showing up, but once and only once in my life I decided to make a Derbyshire tort for dessert for a Christmas dinner where we had 20 people around the table. And it took me, for those who don't know, a Derbyshire tort is a very simple Viennese cake. You bake about 12 layers, each of them about as thin as a cookie. And then you make chocolate buttercream frosting and put it between them, and the top layer is coated with a caramel that's cooked to an exact temperature so that when it dries, it's shiny and shattery. And you pre-score it so you can cut the cake. And that's really all there is to it, but it takes about 11 hours to make one. And as I discovered that Christmas, it takes about 4 minutes to demolish one. Never again.
Tell me
but
about your kids, Michael. They're coming, where they're coming from, how they're going through life. Quell a little bit.
Well, my own son is up in Bend, Oregon, with his two children. And we see them on photographs and FaceTime and such far more often than we'd like to, and by which I mean I'd rather see them in person. I actually have a grandson I haven't even held yet. He's getting too big to hold. But my stepkids, Kelly's four children, are all from the area still. One of them is a mobile technician for Tesla and lives down in Hayward. Our daughter is far more famous than I am. She's the member of the family that has not only World Series rings, but those giant diamond-encrusted manhole covers that the Warriors gave out, because she's a member of the Warriors swoop troop, the folks who come out before the game with the flags and who come out and throw 49-cent T-shirts to people who paid $700 for their tickets and kill each other trying to get a free T-shirt. I have one son who is a postal worker, and he lives in Concord. And the fourth one is retired from the Marine Corps, where he was in special services.
Wow. Wow. I admire the postal worker. My grandfather and I have right on my desk a copper badge. It says U.S. Post Office, Mount Kisco, New York, and it's number one. He was the first postal worker during the Depression in Mount Kisco. And I have a great respect for the mail people. Yes, I mean, they on every level, you talk about Steady Eddie, which is all it's about in life, is consistency and steadiness. And nothing at all really tells consistency every day, no matter what, like the post office. So, tell that man he's doing
well. What was it that Woody Allen said? 90% of life is showing up?
Yes, absolutely. You got to be there. And as a guy, for instance, who's been on Social Security, and there have been times when I haven't had, for one reason or another, the automatic draft that I do now, where it comes right directly from the government to your account at 12:30 the night before, that type of thing. So I've sat around and waited for checks. Now, sometimes the postman or woman has been a little late. But not only have they always gotten there, albeit a little late, that check is always there on a Wednesday. Every time, no exceptions, 9 years, you know, most of it, of course, getting the automatic thing, but that's my point. Very steady. And underappreciated to your world, as most professions are.
Neither rain nor snow nor sleet nor dead of night shall stay this courier from the fulfillment of his appointed rounds.
Nice, nicely put. Wonder who wrote that.
I don't know. I could look it up if you're really interested.
I'm as interested in that as I am in anything else this week. I was really thrown for a loop with Keely's loss. I mean, that hit me in the sense that, A, she was so much younger than Louis Prima, or at least perceived to be at that time, and B, it seems like within the last 2 years, she was performing with Butera, if I'm pronouncing that right, the sax player that played along with the two of them. They did lounges up in Reno. They did concerts down in the Bay Area until very recently. So, you know, to get on the internet and hear that wasn't all that thrilling for me this morning. So
I have your information.
Okay, please.
the Postal Service has no official motto. The popular belief that it does is a tribute to America's postal workers. Neither snow nor rain nor heat nor gloom of night stays these couriers from the swift completion of their appointed rounds. It is not the official Postal Service motto, though it appears chiseled in gray granite over the entry of the James A. Farley Building at 33rd and 8th in Manhattan. Now, here's where it comes from. It predates the post office by just a tad, so we're pretty sure it doesn't apply to postal workers. It comes from paragraph 98 of Book 8 of the Persian Wars by Herodotus. It was written somewhere around 475 B.C. During the wars between the Greeks and Persians, the Persians operated a system of mounted postal couriers who served with great fidelity. So while it is a tribute to postal workers, it's not a tribute to American postal workers by give or take 2,200 years.
Wow. I learned something. See, I thought that Phil Miss from Mount Kisco was the first guy.
Well,
hey, let me tell you something, Michael. He was the first guy for me. That's my pop.
Sure was. Yep.
Yeah. Hey, thank you for getting me through the day, my friend. I'm going to push the button. I want to talk to you off the air for just a second. And ask everybody out there that if they enjoy any of the offerings on the network, if they would be kind enough to box up some lightly used children's books and take them to the Head Start program in whatever community you live. They will always be appreciated and put to good use getting kids interested in anything, and getting them school ready is very, very important. So, thank y'all, and I'll be back.
Can I throw in a word about that? Can I just
Please.
Toss in one quick word about that? It was obvious from our conversation that I have a somewhat unhealthy obsession with food, and
okay.
I just wanted to point out that I pretty much started reading by reading cookbooks, Ralph, and a nice side benefit from reading cookbooks when you're 4 and 5 years old, you have no choice but to learn fractions.
Oh, good point.
Probably the easiest way to teach fractions is with cooking.
And the easiest way to teach decimal is through batting averages on baseball cards.
Absolutely, and my son was able to do those when he was 4. He actually learned to read from recognizing the names on the backs of players that he knew and liked when he was 2.5 and 3 years old.
Wow. Nice. Thank you, Michael. Very
All right,
much appreciated.
Sir. All
we
right.
will be back next week, and Michael and I will be back to do an A's show, and we'll see him down the line. Thank you, everybody. Adios.